Hello, my fellow Whovians and subscribers, and welcome to my latest Doctor Who review, where today I review Doctor Who, The Brain of Morbius, starring Tom Baker as the fourth Doctor. Okay, so The Brain of Morbius. This is the fifth and penultimate serial of season 13 of the show. It was written by Robin Bland. Don't worry, the story is anything but bland. And the plot of this particular Doctor Who story: mad scientist Mendhari Solan is building a body from spare parts to house the disembodied brain of the evil Time Lord, Morbius. He fancies the Doctor's head as the final piece. And that's kind of the basic setup of the story, but the story also involves some history with the Sisterhood of Khan, who basically accused the Doctor of stuff that Morbius has done. And that's kind of it, really. That's the plot. Okay, The Brain of Morbius. This is a very popular Doctor Who story, and it's regarded as a classic, and yep, I love this story. I'm not going to build up any suspense. I'm not going to spare any, you know, any of that, you know. I'm not going to pussyfoot around. I'm just going to come out and say it. I love this Doctor Who story, and what a fantastic story. It really is. I mean, this story kind of has a sort of Frankenstein vibe to it, which I really like, and it really works. The idea of Professor Solon trying to rebuild a body for Morbius, and he just needs the head, you know. He wants to have the Doctor's head as the final piece, but he basically, all Morbius is a brain inside this container in this green liquid. It looks really good, actually. The effect is really quite freaky. But the body is made up of, I think the main body is like a gorilla of some kind or something. Like, it's a very hairy creature. And then he's got a pincer for an arm. He's got Kondo's arm, who's the assistant to Solon. And then he's got this sort of big plastic head and then these things. And then you just hear this voice. And then he's got sort of these boots on as well. It's kind of like a disembodied thing, you know. Pieces of other bodies have been made to form this body. And it's really interesting to see how he's trying to rebuild Morbius. And Morbius, who is actually a Time Lord criminal, which is interesting. Well, I mean, the story is not set on Gallifrey. This story is set in Khan, which is kind of near where Gallifrey is, but not quite. I mean, it's interesting in that regard. And I really like the, you know, Morbius. I think Morbius is a great villain, and the guy that voices him is, who's the voice of Morbius? Michael Spice. Michael Spice does a great job voicing the character. It's a very, very creepy voice. I won't say the voice is as good as Sutek from Pyramids of Mars, but still, it's a creepy enough voice, and I mean, the visual design of the monster is enough to scare anyone, so that kind of works in of itself. So yeah, top marks for the villain. Morbius, really good. I think Solon, played by Philip Madoc, is also a very good villain. He's this nasty bastard of a professor, and he really mistreats his assistant, Kondo, and I really like Kondo as a character. Kondo, played by Colin Fay. Kondo is someone who is a bit of a, you know, he's a big guy. He's quite physically, you know, big, but he's kind-hearted. He's very conflicted in the story. He's a bit dim, but he does have a good heart, so that makes him not quite as dumb as he would appear. Because there's a moment where he is ordered to go and kill Sarah Jane, but he doesn't because he likes her. He's good-hearted and he sees that she's a nice person, and he does stand up to Solon, which is great, and they do have a conflict, and very sadly Kondo dies in the story, which is a shame, but it's nice that they have that fight, and then he shoots him, and then obviously Kondo tries to fight Morbius as well, but sadly he loses his life. But I really like his character and his involvement in the story. He's the most tragic character in the story, which is really, really nice to see, actually, and it was very well written, and the performance is good. I mean, he kind of talks in very loose words, like, Kondo, like, master, kill, order, go. Like, he talks in very few words, but I think that, you know, it works with his character. He's somewhat of a dimwit, and he's waiting to get his arm back, but obviously Solon is not going to give him his arm, but he's just, you know, he's using him. And he basically, for one of his arms, he has like a hook Yeah, it's that's very interesting to see that. I think the Sisterhood of Khan, it's great to see them in this story, and their introduction is good. There's this really sort of weird scene when they're doing this chant and they're saying this sort of like spell and stuff. So there's a lot of mystical sort of weird elements to this story. And the Sisterhood of Khan, the costumes are great. Some of the girls are really quite beautiful, I must say. And Maren, the leader, played by Cynthia Grenville, is very good. Her sort of her departure in this story is quite sudden, I must say. It's a little bit sudden. Happens right at the very end after everything has culminated, and it sort of threw me a bit. So maybe that's my one tiny little nitpick of this story, is that Maren's fate, shall we say, is revealed in kind of an abrupt way. But it's not really a major complaint. But I like her character, and I like the Sisterhood. They're really good, and the sets for this story are brilliant. The production design is great. The Sisterhood set is really good, and the sort of the outside sets are really good. And obviously, you've got all these space shuttles at the beginning, which are there. It looks terrific, and the lab as well. The Dr. Solon's lab is really good as well. This story looks the business. It really does. I mean, wow. This series has really got a consistently good budget for what the sets display anyway. And I think obviously Tom Baker as the Doctor is fabulous in this story. He really carries it. I mean, he's quite funny in the story. He has a lot of funny lines, and there's a great moment at the end when he has a mind battle with Morbius, and we get to see flashbacks of the previous three incarnations of the Doctor. So I thought that was nice, and it was nice that they harked back to that. And he does really well in his scenes with Morbius and also the Sisterhood of Khan, which is really nice. And also I like the dynamic between him and Sarah yet again. Sarah Jane Smith, I mean Elizabeth Sladen in this episode, this is one of her best performances by far. She has to act blind for most of the story because the Sisterhood get rid of her vision because she frees the Doctor when they're about to burn him, and then they get rid of her vision. I will say, I don't know how her vision comes back. I do think that's another criticism of the story, is that I do think it seems that her vision just returns out of nowhere. I would have liked to have known a bit more about why, how her vision came back. If someone could explain that in the comments, then yeah, that would be helpful. But again, it's not a major complaint. I think she does a great job in the story acting terrified, and she does a great job interacting with the characters, especially when she's trying to be blind. And she really is good in this story. She really is fabulous. And I know that we're coming to the end of her time for now. Of course, she'll return in the David Tennant era, but for now, we're going to be saying goodbye to her very soon, which is a real shame. But no, I really like her in this story, and yeah, one of her best performances. She looks terrifying. She's assertive. She's genuinely, she takes charge in this story. When she rescues the Doctor, she does that all on her own. When she disguises herself and unties his rope, which is really good. I think the music of the story is very good as well. I really like the excuse me, the soundtrack for the story. Who else is there? Right, that's the cast. So the creative team behind this story are also very good. The director, Christopher Barry, does a great job with this story. It's like a classic monster movie. It really is. And I think, again, like the previous story, it's just loads of fun. But this story is more intense, I think, than the previous one. I think this story is just twice as intense. And the script is really strong by Robin Bland. Kind of ironic because his surname is Bland. So if this story had turned out bad, then, well, it would have gone against his name, wouldn't it? But no, I really like the script, and it is terrifically strong. And Philip Hinchcliffe should be very proud of this story, because this is a great Doctor Who story. I love just the look of it, and the moment when the brain actually falls on the floor. I mean, God, it looks disgusting when you see the green pus coming out of it. It's really quite dramatic. There's a lot of dramatic moments in this story. And, what can I say? I really love this story, and it kept going at four parts. It didn't drag whatsoever. And like I said, my only minor complaints are like Sarah Jane's vision. I don't know how that sort of comes back, really. Yeah, I don't have a lot else to say about this one, so I'm going to close off by giving this story a 10 out of 10. This is a genuinely fantastic Doctor Who story. This is what Doctor Who is made for. You know, this is why I love the show. Because when you get stuff like this, this is just genuinely what it's supposed to be. And I imagine when this story aired all those years ago in 1976, it would have been genuinely quite terrifying. But there we go. Yeah. Okay, so that's my review of The Brain of Morbius. Please leave your comments down below. Let me know what you think of this story. And stay tuned next time when I review the season finale. Yes, the end of season 13, The Seeds of Doom, which is a 6-part story. But I look forward to it. So, yes, thank you very much. Until next time, see ya.